Vanishing Voices. I'm Anvita Abbi, and we are going to talk about what happens when language dies. Have you ever thought, when a language dies, what dies along with the language? Many people think that it doesn't matter. If language dies, let it die. But it does matter. Why? Because we must ask questions, or we must ask set of questions, that what, when a language is on the verge of extinction, what dies along with the language? Is it its history? Is it its culture? Is it its ecological base? Or its knowledge of the biodiversity? Is it its ethno-linguistic practices? Or the identity of the community? Or all of these? Well, the answer is, most definitely, it is all of these features which extinguish along with the extinct of the language. Languages are the witness of the diverse and varying ways the human cognitive faculties perceive the world. Each language has unique lexical stock and unique signification. Various manifestations of language are ecological and archaeological signatures of the communities that maintain close ties to the environments. I believe that languages carry evidence of earlier environment, earlier habitat, and practices which may or may not be in the memory of the community anymore. Hence, language death signifies the closure of the link with its ancient heritage. As of today, India houses more than 3,000 mother tongues, whether classified or not, but 336 languages are reported by the Government of India, and those languages which are spoken by less than 10,000 speakers are not even reported. However, we know there are 156 languages which are spoken by less than 10,000 speakers, and out of these 156 languages, 56 alone are represented in Jammu and Kashmir. India recognizes out of these large number of languages, only 22 as scheduled languages. According to the UNESCO report, we have 196 languages which are endangered. This figure may not be correct because there are some errors in enumeration by UNESCO. However, one fact is very clear, that languages are getting endangered at a speed which is very alarming. And the rough estimate by linguists for all over the world is that at the end of the century, only 50% of the languages will remain on this globe. In other words, every fortnight a language dies. So we cannot be but very much concerned about this issue of vanishing voices. Languages are treasure trove on literature, on philosophy, and our worldview. Hence, loss of language is the biggest intellectual catastrophe. And ironically, it is we who created this. So, disappearance of an individual language constitutes a monumental loss of scientific information, cultural knowledge, historic account of human migration, and human evolution along with language evolution. Language facilitates enormous power of expression, and each of us must have experienced this. And this offers profound understanding of the world, understanding of life, and scientific knowledge. It is a marker of identity. It is an affinity to our folks, and it also serves as a balm in loneliness, and above all, a spiritual relevance. I remember my last speaker of Bo in Great Andaman used to speak to birds because she thought nobody else understood her. So she was so lonely that she had to take recourse to talking to birds. So this is only shows us that language also serves as a kind of a balm in your loneliness. Ironically, it is the bulk of the tribal languages that are endangered in South Asia. Majority of Indian language users, if not all South Asian users, are multilingual, giving varied dimensions to this linguistic diversity which seems to be now at loss. There's another interesting aspect about long language. The extinction of each language results in the irrecoverable loss of unique cultural, historical and ecological knowledge. Biologists have proved that strongest ecosystems are those which are most diverse, and specifically there's an inextricable relationship. Please, I'll repeat, there's an inextricable relation between linguistic and ecological diversity. Remember, every time a language dies, we have less evidence for understanding patterns in the structure and function of human language or human prehistory and maintenance of the world's diverse ecosystem. There are many examples that I can think of which shows the inextricable relationship between the ecology and language. I remember that in the name of the development, when tribes are moved or displaced from their local environment, they not only lose the words for the fauna and flora that they saw in their original habitat, they also lose the capability of recognizing those items. So this harms the capability function of humans because of the loss of language. The loss of language or the loss of their original habitat actually leads to deprivation of expression, loss of words, and also erosion of grammatical structure. The net result is on the cognitive abilities that become restricted and limited. I can remember there are many color terms which are being lost to younger generation, because which were there in the older generation, because they could associate the various colors with various items which are no longer there in the ecology. So gradual ecological destruction is deleting words from the language and subsequently from the memory of the humans, and that's a very big loss. Many times I have heard the arguments, the scholars saying that how does it matter, one language dies, it can be replaced by another language. But no language can be replaced by another language. One language can evolve into new languages, like Latin evolved into new languages, or the old Sanskrit evolved into newer languages, but replacement never can compensate for the loss. The symbiotic relationship that exists between language and the ecological environment cannot be attained by the replacement language. The species specific quality is language learning ability. Now, this is genetically coded, as we know. FOXP2 is the gene by which we learn languages. But in addition to that, the development of the language is a biocultural hybrid, a product of intensive gene culture evolution. This theory was proposed by Evans and Levinson in 2009 and is very true by looking at other evidences in the languages. It is the co-evolutionary nature of human language and the system that underlies it that provides us with evidential proofs that it is not only constituted of rules but also manifests ways and means by which the speaker perceives the world and develops the cognitive abilities. Grammar represents rules, as we know, and it also represents systematics of the conceptualization of the world by a society with reference to the self. One of the most important tasks that a grammar and lexicons of any language accomplishes is the establishment of the identity of its speakers through its intricate and complex rules of language and use. The constructs of grammar thus establishes the existence of self, since each distinct grammar represents the cognitive abilities of the speaker and a distinct worldview. I am reminded of some of the examples from Northeastern languages. They have a very large number of what linguists call expressive words, and these words indicate various kinds of manner of action. Similarly, I am also reminded of that in Kuruk, a Dravidian language spoken in central India, has the community has two distinct grammars, one which is used by men to men, another by woman to woman. So the grammars are not just set of rules, they also indicate the way community perceive their world. I'm also reminded of the great Indomani's language, which has body division markers associated to every part of speech. In other words, Great Andamanese divides its body into 7 different divisions represented by monosyllables like a, oth, r. And these monosyllables are then attached to different words which belong to different parts of speech. So, for example, the verb to go, which is an exit, takes the body division marker, which actually is used for those aspects, those parts of body which come out of the body, like sweat and blood and hair and so on and so forth. Similarly, if somebody has a pain which is inside, internalized into the body, takes a different body division marker. And similarly, the same division body marker will be also for the word like thinking, because it's the internalized activity. So that this kind of association of body to the world is only the worldview of the great Andamanese, who had been hunter and gatherers and have been representing the oldest civilization perhaps on this earth, because they migrated from Africa 70,000 years before present. We agree with Amartya Sen that poverty is not only about economic conditions and growth. Expansion of human capabilities is more locus of poverty and more basic objective of development. I have seen that for tribal children and for children from the villages, sometimes the dominant language medium, education, curtails the development of their capabilities and perpetuates poverty. We would like to add that orality should be maintained and the traditional environment knowledge in the unwritten languages should be extracted and disseminated to the rest of the world. And hence, oral tradition is as important as written.